Welcome to First Christian Church. We're glad to have you here worshiping with us today, whether you're here with us in the room or those of you that are watching along with us online. We're thankful that you've chosen to be here and be part of our service here today. We are missing the Edmondson family this morning, our senior minister, if you're not sure who that is. They're out of town this week on vacation, so we hope they're having a great time and have a great trip back when they return later this week. But thankful for those of you that could be here and be part of today's service. We'd like to begin, before we go into our time of worship, by just briefly reading from Psalm 27 to lead us into our time of worship. So let's listen to God's word. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked advance against me to devour me, it is my enemies and my foes who will stumble and fall. Though an army besiege me, my heart will not fear. Though war break out against me, even then I will be confident. One thing I ask from the Lord, this only do I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze on the beauty of the Lord and to seek him in his temple. For in the day of trouble he will keep me safe in his dwelling. He will hide me in the shelter of his sacred tent and set me high upon a rock. And then my head will be exalted above the enemies who surround me. And at his sacred tent I will sacrifice with shouts of joy. I will sing and make music to the Lord. Hear my voice when I call, Lord. Be merciful to me and answer me. My heart says of you, seek his face. Your face, Lord, I will seek. Do not hide your face from me. Do not turn your servant away in anger. You have been my helper. Do not reject me or forsake me, God, my Savior. Though my father and mother forsake me, the Lord will receive me. Teach me your way, Lord. Lead me in a straight path because of my oppressors. Do not turn me over to the desire of my foes, for false witnesses rise up against me, spouting malicious accusations. But I remain confident in this. I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait for the Lord. Be strong and take heart and wait for the Lord. This morning, as we have gathered to share in God's word, to share in his table, and to share in music and singing, I hope you'll take confidence in these words and give your full heart and attention to God this morning. Let's stand as we sing and worship.
Prince of Peace, and I will live my life for you.
Our scripture reading is from the book of Isaiah. You who are far away, hear what I have done. You who are near, acknowledge my power. The sinners in Zion are terrified. Trembling grips the godless. Who of us can dwell with a consuming fire? Who of us can dwell with everlasting burning? Those who walk righteously and speak what is right, who reject gain from extortion and keep their hands from accepting bribes, who stop their ears against plots of murder and shut their eyes against contemplating evil, they are the ones who will dwell on the heights, whose refuge will be the mountain fortress. Their bread will be supplied, and water will not fail them. Your eyes will see the king in his beauty, and view a land that stretches afar. In your thoughts, you will ponder the former terror. Where is that chief officer? Where is the one who took the revenue? Where is the officer in charge of the towers? You will see those arrogant people no more, people whose speech is obscure, whose language is strange and incomprehensible. Look on, Zion, the city of our festivals. Your eyes will see Jerusalem, a peaceful abode, a tent that will not be moved. Its stakes will never be pulled up, nor any of its ropes broken. There the Lord will be our mighty one. It will be like a place of broad rivers and streams. No galley with oars will ride them. No mighty ship will sail them. For the Lord is our judge. The Lord is our lawgiver. The Lord is our king. It is he who will save us. You may be seated.
Boldly I come into his arms with nothing to bring. Because he does. Tired and afraid, forgotten what's paid, so I'll hide in my shame like an orphan in chains. I ran from my promise, but it's never enough, 'cause my walls and my mountains always ran out of luck. And I can't do anything to deserve. Just loves me 'cause he loves me 'cause he loves me just because he does. I'm his beloved, I am his friend, his love has no separate me from chance. Not heaven or hell, nor darkness or light, will ever deny you of his wonderful smile. So I won't be silent, it's too good to be true. He just loves you, 'cause he loves you, 'cause he loves you, 'cause he loves you.
Please join me in prayer, and as we begin, let us read from Psalm 24. The earth is the Lord's, and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. For he founded it on the seas and established it on the waters. Who may ascend the mountain of the Lord? Who may stand in his holy place? The one who has clean hands and a pure heart, who does not trust in an idol or swear by a false god. They will receive blessing from the Lord and vindication from God their Savior. Such is the generation of those who seek him, who seek your face, God of Jacob. Lift up your heads, you gates. Be lifted up, you ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord, strong and mighty. The Lord, mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, you gates. Lift them up, you ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is he, this King of glory? The Lord Almighty. He is the King of glory. Father, we thank you this morning for the magnificent gift of your creation. Lord, from electrons spinning on their atoms to planets spinning on their axes, what you've created are unfathomable miracles. Lord, you made the earth and gave it to us as our home. This gift, we know, is not one of ownership, but of stewardship. That which you have given and was not meant to sustain us was meant to inspire us, was meant to demonstrate your goodness and your power, was meant to remind us that beyond the food we eat and the water we drink and how we build our homes, that you've created something beautiful, that you've given us a reason to be sustained. That is this, to worship you in the midst of all this beauty. For how else should we respond to the creator of all the universe? Father, forgive us as we forget this. Forgive us as we forget you. Forgive us when we forget what you said at the end of each day of creation as you looked upon the labor of your love and said, "This is good." Forgive us our temptation to look upon the labor of your love and say, "This could be better." Forgive our wanton urge for growth. Forgive our desire for development. It is we who need development. It is we who need growth. And only the growth that you can provide, the growth of a seed buried in promise, the growth that only comes from patience. God, we thank you for the miracle of our community, the body of your Son, and our neighbors. May we bring no harm to the body or to our neighbors or to your name as we strive to live our lives in the example of Christ our Lord. Forgive us as we harm each other, as we forget each other, neglect each other, lose each other. Help us to find each other. Those next to us but far in heart, those near in heart but far away. And help us find you in them. And help them find you in us. Lord, we thank you for the miracle of our bodies. It was our sin that introduced malady into our lives, that brought the fear of death to our hearts. And yet the miracle of your creation still lives within this flesh. Our most advanced medicines are not improvements on the chemical contents of your creation, Lord, but rather are mechanisms to allow the body to do what you designed it to do. Every second of every day, our bodily functions continue without malfunction. But you've planned even for those malfunctions. You've planned even for us and our poor choices. You've planned even for how we neglect ourselves, how we poison ourselves, how we insult ourselves, how we reject your design for our lives and bring ourselves harm and ruin. Forgive us, God, as we forget this most fundamental truth of our lives, that we are your creation, and above all, are made in your image. In all these things, Lord, we pray that your glory be revealed, that it be revealed in your creation, that it be revealed in the world around us, that it be revealed in the community around us, that it be revealed in the hearts within us. May you be glorified, O loving and magnificent Creator. These things we pray in the name of your Son, through whom all this was made. Amen.
Good morning. So I guess it's been close to 15 years now since I've rededicated my life to God. And since then, in one way or another, many of those years I've served in leadership here at FCC. And with that being said, yeah, I've not always been a good Christian, whatever that really means. It's kind of a loaded phrase, but still. But what I mean by that is, you know, there's been times that I've made bad decisions, whether it's from selfishness, laziness, just a rebellious nature. You know, my thoughts have not always been on good things. My words sometimes have been used to criticize or gossip instead of to build up. My actions and my words and my thoughts have not always been in tune with God. And I imagine I'm not alone in this. And it's at these times when we sin and are weak that we tend to want to draw away from God, mostly due to shame or frustration. Because it's hard to pray and worship when you don't really feel worthy. But in reality, that's what is needed most. As followers of Christ, we strive to live a life like Jesus. But in the moments where we don't, we should strive to move nearer to him in humbleness and reverence. Gathering together this morning as the community of God is one way we do that. When we take the Lord's Supper, it's a continuation of this community that we are living as God's people. We draw strength and encouragement from one another as our spirits worship our Creator as one. Todd mentioned this last week, that the Lord's Supper is a mysterious and wonderful thing. And I think it's something to be embraced fully. So when we eat the bread and we drink the juice, if you've struggled lately, let your soul be refreshed with the remembrance of what was accomplished through Jesus. If you feel like you're a little higher up the mountain this morning, still be encouraged by the blood of Jesus, but also remember your brother and sister sitting next to you in prayer. The tempter is a savage lion, always ready to pounce, but we take away his power when we live and worship as the kingdom of God.
Of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious song and sung by flaming tongues.
Let's pray. Gracious God, we give you thanks for always and faithfully gathering your people to this expression of worship that we call communion for the reasons that Seth just mentioned, that this is not a cure for loneliness or a medicine for what ails us, but it is a communion, a place where we commune with each other and with you, that we engage with what you have done, what you are doing, and what you continue to do and will do, where we learn to be your people, to be people that your Son, Jesus Christ, has taught us to be, and the people that your Holy Spirit empowers us to be. So God, we come to this table now. We take the bread that is your body. We take the cup that is your blood. And we take them as communion, as a reminder of not a one of us are doing this alone, and that we are a body that is under your care and under your watch, that bears witness to what you have done in the death, the burial, and the resurrection of our Savior, Jesus Christ. And it's in his name that we pray. Amen. On the night when he was betrayed, Jesus took the bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "This is my body, broken for you. Do this as often as you eat it in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup also after supper. Poured it out, and he gave it to his disciples. He said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Gracious God, we give you thanks that we are a people that does not leave who we are as your people in this room. Father, that we leave this place every Sunday afternoon, and that we have an entire week to practice who we are. Practice the people we're becoming whenever we sit and gather in this room. And so, Father, we now in this moment have the opportunity to practice one of the ways that we are being shaped by your goodness, by your faithfulness in our lives. And that is simply to respond with our financial gifts, to entrust them to the care, not only to it's your care, but to the care of those that have oversight locally, that they are prayerfully and mindfully using these resources to carry out your good work, however it may be done. And even when it's not maybe exactly how we would do it ourselves, we trust that your body that is just gathered for communion is a body that is at its strongest and at its best whenever it does things together, does things unified. And so our prayer as we come to you with our offerings is that you would bring us together in as close to one mind as we can be with these gifts, knowing that all of us have the same desire, that your will be done with them. We ask all this in your Son's name. Amen.
This morning we're continuing a series going through the book of John, the Gospel of John, which we've been doing for several months now. And this morning we're going to look at a couple of the more difficult moments in the life and ministry of Jesus, found in John chapter 18. We're specifically going to look at verses 1 through 18 and 25 through 27. Just to give you some context, because we've jumped around a little bit the last couple of weeks, this takes place soon after Jesus and his disciples had shared in the Last Supper. And it's immediately after Jesus has prayed in the garden. And it's a familiar passage, but a heartbreaking series of events that are leading our Lord to the cross. And I have to admit, I usually can't wait to skip past this part of the story and get to the good news that's coming at the end. But there's much to be learned from seeing how Jesus dealt with the betrayals and denials of two of his closest friends. And so as we go through this today and read through that passage in just a moment, I encourage you to read along with me using your Bible, or you can follow along on the screen. Let's listen to God's word together. When he had finished praying, Jesus left with his disciples and crossed the Kidron Valley. On the other side, there was a garden, and he and his disciples went into it. Now Judas, who betrayed him, knew the place, because Jesus had often met there with his disciples. So Judas came to the garden, guiding a detachment of soldiers and some officials from the chief priests and the Pharisees. They were carrying torches, lanterns, and weapons. Jesus, knowing all that was going to happen to him, went out and asked them, "Who is it you want?" "Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. "I am he," Jesus said. And Judas the traitor was standing there with them. When Jesus said, "I am he," they drew back and fell to the ground. Again he asked them, "Who is it that you want?" "Jesus of Nazareth," they said. Jesus answered, "I told you that I am he. If you're looking for me, then let these men go." This happened so that the words he had spoken would be fulfilled: "I have not lost one of those you gave me." Then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it and struck the high priest's servant, cutting off his right ear. The servant's name was Malchus. Jesus commanded Peter, "Put your sword away. Shall I not drink the cup the Father has given me?" Then the detachment of soldiers with its commander and the Jewish officials arrested Jesus. They bound him and brought him first to Annas, who was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, the high priest that year. Caiaphas was the one who had advised the Jewish leaders. that it would be good if one man died for the people. Simon Peter and another disciple were following Jesus, and because this disciple was known to the high priest, he went with Jesus into the high priest's courtyard, but Peter had to wait outside at the door. The other disciple, who was known to the high priest, came back, spoke to the servant girl on duty there, and brought Peter in. "You aren't one of this man's disciples too, are you?" she asked Peter. He replied, "I am not." It was cold, and the servants and officials stood around a fire they had made to keep warm. Peter was also standing with them, warming himself. Meanwhile, Simon Peter was still standing there warming himself, and so they asked him, "You aren't one of his disciples too, are you?" He denied it, saying, "I am not." One of the high priest's servants, a relative of the man whose ear Peter had cut off, challenged him, "Didn't I see you with him in the garden?" Again, Peter denied it, and at that moment, a rooster began to crow. Betrayal and denial. Doesn't that just sort of boil your blood a little bit when people do those kinds of things to one another? When a kid sells out the best friend they grew up with just because they're trying to be cool and fit in with others. When a teenager lies to their parents about where they're going and ends up in big trouble after making one bad choice after another. When a parent is unwilling or unable to care for their own child and gives them up or abandons them. When adult children can't be bothered to care for their elderly parents, so they send them away or just ignore them. When a teacher or coach or religious leader abuses a child in their care or fails morally. When a boss promises you a promotion but gives it to someone else less deserving. When your spouse or significant other is unfaithful and cheats with someone else. These kinds of acts of betrayal and denial and others like it have become so common. It often begs the question of us, can anyone be trusted to not betray or deny others? When you are betrayed or denied by others that you've trusted, how do you respond? How do you wish you could respond if you had the power and the means to dish out vigilante justice? High school, I was not a very enthusiastic reader when my English teacher gave us books to read and report on. But one book that caught my and held my attention was The Count of Monte Cristo by Alexandre Dumas. After I learned that it was not a book about a sandwich, and I also learned it was written by the same guy who wrote The Three Musketeers, which was not a book about a candy bar, I went on and read the book and learned one of the greatest stories ever written about betrayal and revenge. Around 2002, a movie version of The Count of Monte Cristo came out, and it became one of my favorite movies. Not just because I already knew and loved the story from the book that I read in high school, but also because of the unexpected experience that I had watching it in a packed theater with a very enthusiastic crowd. I can't remember exactly where I was, but I distinctly remember how vocal and animated the audience was throughout the movie. Something about the story moved the people that were there to react to what happened very strongly. Early in the movie, the main character, Edmond Dantès, is betrayed by Fernand Mondego. And in the theater, there were audible gasps of shock and people shouting in different areas, "Oh no, he didn't!" Later in the movie, when Edmond begins exacting his carefully crafted acts of revenge as the Count of Monte Cristo, people in the audience were cheering and saying things like, "He's gonna get it now," or "That's right." Then at the end of the movie, we see the words on the screen, "God will give me justice," carved into the wall of the prison cell of Chateau d'If that Dantès had spent many years in. And the audience got up and gave a standing ovation as revenge had been carried out in many ways. It was really an incredible movie watching experience, and while I myself am not the personality that jumped in and participated in the outburst reactions that all the others had, I really resonated with how everyone felt in those moments of the story, because betrayals are disturbing and painful. Revenge is sometimes very sweet, and justice can be very satisfying. For anyone who has experienced betrayal or denial from someone that they loved and that they trusted, that desire to seek out revenge and hurt others in the same way or worse than they have hurt you is something that we can all understand. When trust is broken in tragic ways, it becomes very difficult not only to try to restore trust with that person, but also to even build trust with anyone else. Those who are betrayed often feel foolish, weak, vulnerable in those moments, as if they not only could have, but should have been able to prevent it from happening. And one thing's clear, they never want it to happen again. Today, as we consider the betrayal and denial of Judas and Peter against Jesus, we might have some part of us that really wants to see justice done through some form of punishment against them because of our love for who Jesus is. But is this how Jesus himself responded to them? What can we learn from this passage about Jesus and about ourselves, and how we too ought to treat those who betray or deny us in ways that often feel very painful to endure and impossible to respond to in a loving way? How can we move forward towards reconciliation and restoration with those who have wronged us instead of retribution and revenge and the regret that tends to follow those actions? And so the first thing that we can kind of see in this passage in John chapter 18 is that Jesus really knows that his friends can hurt him, yet he still risks having a close relationship with them. Way back in John chapter 6, which we talked about probably a couple months ago, Jesus is at a point in his ministry where he's teaching in the synagogue in Capernaum. He says a few things that really raise the eyebrows of everyone who heard it, including his disciples. His comments are so difficult to understand that they not only solidify his enemies against him, but they even cause his disciples to question if they should be following this man who's saying some very strange and shocking things about people eating his flesh and drinking his blood. And after this moment, after this message that Jesus gives, it says that many of his disciples left. Not the 12, but you know, the others that were following. And in this moment of what must have been something very painful, seeing people that he knew and loved and cared about turn their back on him, Jesus looks at his 12 closest friends, the 12 disciples, and asks if they want to leave too. He also, in this moment, alludes to the fact that he knows one of them, Judas, is going to be betraying him later, although nobody understands at that time what he's talking about, probably Judas himself. In moments like these, when relationships end, when people turn our back on us, when they betray or deny us, people often question whether or not they ever should have begun a relationship with somebody in the first place. The more deeply you love someone, the more painful it is when they don't feel the same or when they turn their back on you. When someone betrays or leaves us, we sometimes assume everyone else probably wants to also. And it seems to make sense to us that we could avoid all this drama, we could avoid all these problems if we never let people into our lives. If we always keep others at a distance, we don't have to risk the pain that comes when a relationship breaks. This is not a real solution, though, because we were not made by God to be alone. We need relationships with others. We need to love and be loved. And Jesus, after this moment, continues to love and remain close with his disciples. And it's not because they deserve it, not even because they're always agreeing with him and everything or making him happy all the time, but it's because of who he is and how he chooses to love others. Even knowing already what Judas and Peter would eventually do to him at the most critical moment of his life, he continues time after time to show them love, trust, and kindness. We can see this in John chapter 18 as Jesus and the other 11 disciples still go to this garden that was known to Judas. Judas was part of that inner circle, knew where this special place was. And rather than hide when Judas and the others arrive with weapons and lanterns and torches in hand, Jesus himself goes out to meet them, and it doesn't shy away from identifying himself. According to the other gospel accounts, Jesus even allows Judas to draw close enough to kiss him, which was the sign that he was the one to arrest. I feel it's important, even as we think about these things, we think about Jesus' response, his willingness to risk things, to risk pain and hurt from his friends, because of the value he places on loving people and the relationship he can have with them. I feel it's important that when we think about how we apply this for ourselves, that it doesn't mean that we should all remain in chronically unhealthy or abusive relationships that do real harm to us. In most cases, though, with most of the people we know and love, we can and should be willing to endure some measure of difficult times with them, with those that we love. We should be willing to extend the same amount of forgiveness that we hope they would extend to us when we make mistakes, when we do the wrong things. But we do that with people that we have some willingness and ability to rebuild trust with, not with people that are doing us real harm and are dangerous relationships for us. But relationships are important, and they're very valuable. We should choose them wisely. When something goes wrong and someone betrays us or denies us in some way, we don't have to rush to cut off a relationship with somebody that hurts us through a betrayal or a denial. It might be wise to take some time and some space, step back, but don't make the mistake of isolating yourself from maybe forming new relationships with others or seeing if God will open a door for you to restore what's lost in that moment, even though it can be a very difficult thing to do. One of the next things we see in this passage from John chapter 18 is that Jesus sees his friend's weakness, yet he still prays for and serves them. Jesus' love for Judas and Peter is not one that comes out of ignorance for who they were, what they would do. Jesus is not desperate and unable to have relationships with any others. He simply knows the flaws of his friends, and he knows about their future failures, but he still calls them to be his friends and his disciples. And not only did Jesus know about and allude to Judas's betrayal way back in John chapter 6, which we referred to just a little bit ago, but he even clearly calls it out in the John 13 passage, which is describing the Lord's Supper. And he does it in kind of a dramatic way. He loudly announces it to all the disciples that one of them will betray him. And then he shares with a select few there at the meal a very specific sign that's going to reveal that Judas is the one that's going to do it. And then he even goes so far as to serve Judas the communion elements, to give him a piece of bread and say to him, what you are about to do, do quickly. Now this is a little unusual to me to imagine that if you really knew somebody was about to stab you in the back, how could you sit next to them? How could you share a meal with them? How could you let them leave to go harm you in the way that they're going to harm you? But something about Jesus' way of dealing with people is to still extend to them the same measure of love and hospitality that he did to the others. Even before this moment, when Jesus serves the communion elements to Judas, Jesus also washed Judas's feet along with the other disciples. He also seems to pray for him along with all the other disciples when he's in the garden and Judas is on the way with the soldiers and religious leaders to arrest him. Now, granted, in his prayer, which we looked at in John chapter 17, Jesus does confess that he knows Judas is lost and he is in some way already doomed to destruction because of what he's done. But despite that, he still serves him. He still loves him. Then in the moment when Judas arrives, you know, as we read in the other accounts, he betrays him with a kiss of all things. Judas doesn't oppose him. He doesn't push him away or seek to harm him or anyone else that's with him in any way. Some of his reaction is certainly because he understands and has accepted that this is part of God's plan for him. This is something greater is at work behind all of this. But I also think that Jesus' restraint is just another action of service and love that prevents Judas and others there with him from being harmed. Now, we can add to the story of Judas and all these things that we can see about the way Jesus treats him, despite what he's doing to him. We can add to all of these things that Jesus also does a lot of these things for Peter, who is also going to deny him as a friend, deny even knowing him. Again, looking back to John 13, after washing Peter's feet, despite his own objections, Jesus reveals directly to Peter, "You're going to disown me three times before the rooster crows." And then immediately after that, Peter is still trusted to remain close to him, trusted to go with him and all the different things that will happen. And as we will see later on, trusted with many things in the future, even after his betrayal and denial. As we jump back into John chapter 18, we see this moment where Peter does the thing that we kind of wish maybe Jesus would do when Judas shows up. He's the one that yanks out the sword, chops off the ear of one of these servants, one of the religious leaders that's there. And that's the kind of revenge that we long for when someone is being wronged, when something bad is happening to somebody, especially someone we love, like Jesus. And yet when he does this, Jesus stops him. He tells him to put the sword away. In doing so, he's not only thinking of the person who Peter attacks, but probably thinking of everyone else that's there, and Peter himself, who could have been the first casualty if this had broken into an all-out battle between those that were there. But as we read on in John chapter 18, Peter still denies Jesus anyway. Despite all of these things that Jesus has done for him, all the love that he's shown, and even being warned that he was going to do that. And it says in Luke's account of Peter's denial that right after the third denial, right after the rooster crows, it says in Luke's gospel that Jesus actually turned and looked straight at Peter. For both Judas and Peter, there were these moments in this story where there's no place to run, no place to hide after they've betrayed and denied Jesus and broken that relationship. They had no reason to fear the Lord because Jesus had shown them nothing but love to this point. But they did have to face themselves. They did have to face the consequences of the choices that they had made. And many of those consequences, Jesus himself was the one that bore the brunt of. In your own life, do you have the strength, courage, and conviction to actually pray for and serve those people who have betrayed and denied you, rather than seek out revenge against them? Can you truly love people up to and even beyond the moment that they betray you and deny you? With God, all things are possible, but they aren't always easy. We are to love even our enemies, and Jesus shows us the way. Finally, in this passage in John chapter 18, we see that Jesus suffers severe consequences because of their actions, yet he still seeks to forgive and reconcile with them. The consequences that Jesus will suffer are going to be looked at more in some of the coming messages as we continue to go through the book of John. So I'm not going to spend much time on that. But the unfortunate reality is that when people sin against others through these acts of betrayal and denial, innocent people suffer. This is not the way that God wants us to live. This is not how we should treat one another, especially those that we love and trust. But it happens so often. Nothing about Jesus on the cross bearing the penalty for our sin is fair. He was innocent and did not deserve that. But Jesus not only endures the consequences of their betrayal, he also offers them both an opportunity to receive forgiveness and reconciliation by continuing on the mission to do his Father's will. That doesn't mean that they both accepted it, but he was still willing to do his part in offering exactly what they needed to fix this brokenness that they had created. In Luke's account of the crucifixion from the cross, at one point Jesus says, "Father, forgive them, they know not what they do. And while this is not directed specifically at Judas and Peter alone, it's hard to imagine that these were not on his mind in light of how recently these events had happened before the cross. Judas, perhaps even before the crucifixion, we read elsewhere, when confronted with his guilt, has deep remorse and resentment. He returns the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and elders, who themselves acknowledge that it's blood money. We can't accept it as an offering, and so they use it in a different way. The timeline of when exactly it happens is unclear, but Judas apparently cannot overcome his despair at what he's done and the consequences that Jesus has had to endure as a result. He does not receive the reconciliation or forgiveness of Jesus because he instead decides to take his own life in that despair. I have to admit, there are many times I've read through that passage of what happens to Judas, and I thought to myself, good. He got what he deserved. I don't think Jesus took any delight in what happened to Judas, despite the terrible thing that Judas had done to him. I honestly believe that if Judas had repented of his sin, had sought forgiveness from Jesus, and had waited to see what Jesus was going to do in the resurrection, things could have been different. He could have received that forgiveness. He could have been reconciled in ways that are hard for me to imagine. Unlike Judas, Peter, however, when confronted with his guilt, feels deep sadness. It says he goes out and he weeps at the gate. He repents of the sin that he had committed, eventually reconciles with Jesus later in John 21, which I'm sure we'll look at as well in the future. And he even goes so far as to return to the rest of the disciples. And he's there at the moment when Sunday morning of Easter Sunday, he can go run to the empty tomb. And he's there to meet and see Jesus face to face after the resurrection. And the rest, they say, is history, because Peter has this opportunity to be reinstated, to be forgiven, and to receive that, and to be reconciled, and to be trusted again, to become a key leader in the early church. Now for ourselves, when you're the one who is betrayed or denied by others, and when you suffer the consequences of others' sins, forgiveness and reconciliation are probably not on the top of your to-do list. I get that. It's so much easier to consider seeking revenge or falling into a pit of despair. But Jesus calls us to something greater, even though it's difficult. He has shown us the way by suffering himself for our sake, so that we could be forgiven while he was condemned. And in turn, he wants us, as his followers, to forgive others as we have been forgiven. As we conclude today's message, I hope you will remember the example of Jesus in your relationship with others. It's worth taking the risk to love other people well and give them your trust, even if some people might hurt you in that process. We should pray for and serve others, even those who are weak, even those who have wronged us in some way, maybe especially for them, even when they don't deserve it, but we know they'll benefit from it. Greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. And if you are willing to be the kind of friend that endures suffering at the hand of your friends and loved ones, that extends forgiveness to those who have harmed you, that seeks reconciliation and relationships that have been broken, even when it's not your fault, you could discover that with God's help, something much sweeter than revenge is available to you and to those whom you love. Love other people like Christ has loved you in this way. In a moment, our worship team is going to come up and play an invitation song for us. And this is an opportunity that we offer each week for people who have not done so before to accept the forgiveness that's offered through Jesus' death and resurrection. encourage you, if you've not done so, to choose the path of Peter, who believed that Jesus was the Christ, the Son of God. He repented of his sin. He confessed him as his Lord and Savior, and then he walked faithfully in a new life that was immersed in Christ. You can choose to do the same today. But so many others don't choose that. They choose to wallow in their weakness, to fall into that pit of despair. And I warn you that that's not why Jesus died on the cross, for you to do those things, for you to abandon the gift that he extends to you through his death and his resurrection. We also offer this time of invitation for anyone who needs prayer. We strive to be a Christian community that loves one another and bears one another's burdens. And so we encourage you to seek out help from your brothers and sisters in Christ here today if you need it. You're invited to either come forward during the next song or talk to someone before you leave today if they can help you and if you can be a good friend. Now we're going to stand and sing a great song, What a Friend We Have in Jesus. And as we do, let's consider how Jesus demonstrated that to his friends, even the ones that treated him poorly. Let's stand and sing.
What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear. All because we do not carry everything to God in
close in prayer. In just a moment, I'd like to just share a few announcements of some things coming up this week. First, tomorrow night is our monthly board meeting at 6 o'clock. If you'd like to come be part of that, you're welcome to, or share anything with any of the leaders that will be meeting. Just want you to be aware that that meeting is taking place tomorrow night here at the church at 6 o'clock. A little later in the week, on Wednesday, we will, I think, have our next adult Bible study discussion, I believe, at 6:30 is when that's going on. At the same time, we are also going to have our next Operation Christmas Child Craft Night. We've been doing that sort of alongside the adults meeting. The youth are taking a break for the summer, but they can either join the adults if they'd like or come help out at the craft night with the kids. And that will also be happening at the same time, 6:30 to 7:30. Ronnie, is that happening in this building or across the street? So across the street in the fellowship hall. I believe the adults will be meeting here. So we invite you to come and be part of that. Some special instructions for the craft this week as well that Ginger shared with me is that there's going to be some painting going on. So any kids that are coming or youth or adults that want to help, be prepared for that. Maybe wear some clothing that it's okay if it gets some paint on it. I don't think we're going to go too wild. No Picassos going on or anything like that. But just be prepared for that if you want to be part of that this week. And then next week, you've probably seen this if you've picked up a bulletin today. We're having a Father's Day breakfast at 9 a.m. next Sunday. Really helps us out if you can let us know if you're coming and how many are coming. So please fill that out for us today. You can leave it in the back or come drop it in one of the plates up here if you haven't done that yet today. Or call us during the week. Feel free to call the church office and let us know if you're coming. Come have coffee or juice or milk and breakfast with Dad is sort of how it says it on there. So, anything else that I'm missing? Any other announcements anyone else is aware of? If not, then we'll close with a word of prayer. God, we again thank you for the opportunity to be here today, to have spent this time worshiping and lifting up your name. And even as we've looked at some passages of scripture today that are, you know, not the most exciting things to talk about, not the most joyful and uplifting things, what is joyful and uplifting to us is the example of Christ. And the challenge that gives us to try to live up to that, to try to be Christ-like in how we love other people and how we deal with the people around us. And so as we prepare to go out this week, I pray especially for anyone that is going through a difficult time right now with a friend or family member or coworker or someone else, and they needed to hear these words today and put them into practice and consider the example of Christ. And if none of us are going through that at this moment, I'm sure, you know, that will happen at some point in the future, and we need the example of your son. But more than anything else, we leave today so grateful that this is how Christ has treated us as well. And in the many ways that our sin has betrayed and denied him and you, we're so grateful that you made a way for us through your son. And so as we carry that good news with us and we live in the peace and rest that that brings us, may we also extend that and share that with other people as we go from here. Be with us in the week to come. Help us to glorify you in all that we say and do. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Go in peace.